On November 30th, 2021, 15-year-old Ethan Robert Crumbley entered the Oxford High School in Oxford Township, Michigan, armed with a 9mm firearm and a sinister plan. As students navigated the corridors during class changes, Crumbley unleashed terror, firing indiscriminately at the defenseless children. The devastating spree claimed the lives of 4 students and left 7 others, including a teacher, wounded. Authorities arrested and charged the teenager as an adult for 24 crimes, including murder and terrorism. Crumbley pleaded guilty to all of the charges in October 2022 and later received a sentence of life without the possibility of parole, plus an additional 24 years. 5 days before Ethan Crumbley received his sentence, prosecutors charged his parents, Jennifer and James Crumbley, with involuntary manslaughter. They argued that the parents' neglect contributed to the tragedy. Legal proceedings involving the Crumbleys garnered national attention, as it's not often that parents are taken to court over what their kids do, especially in school shootings. This case is widely considered by many to have significant implications for how courts interpret parental responsibility in the context of gun ownership and the measures parents must take to ensure the safety and well-being of their children and the public. Let's dive in. Jennifer and James Crumbley lived with their 15-year-old son Ethan in a home in Oxford, Michigan, just north of Detroit. Jennifer grew up in Clarkston, a Detroit suburb, and worked full-time as the marketing director for a real estate acquisitions company. James worked as a driver for the food delivery company DoorDash, but previously a technology company from San Francisco named Monarch terminated their relationship with him as an independent contractor just 5 months into their agreement. The Crumbleys appeared relatively stable financially, mainly relying on Jennifer's income. Over the past year, they spent up to $20,000 to house, feed, and care for their multiple horses kept in a nearby barn. Regarding their legal history, they previously had a few brushes with the law, consisting of misdemeanors, but they have no history of violent offenses. In 2003, Jennifer faced charges related to check fraud, but prosecutors dismissed the case. The following year, she was convicted of a similar offense and paid a small fine. In 2005, Jennifer and James were fined $652 each for driving under the influence. Additionally, James received fines on other occasions for multiple traffic-related offenses. The Crumbleys gave birth to their son Ethan on April 28, 2006. At the time, they lived in Atlantic Beach, Florida, but eventually relocated to Washington State. By age 8, the Crumbleys had allowed Ethan unlimited access to graphic video games such as Call of Duty, which are rated suitable for older teens and adults by content rating systems worldwide. Video games became his primary interest. The Crumbleys eventually settled in Oxford, Michigan in 2014. They bought their home near downtown Oxford in 2015, where outsiders began to notice troubling signs. From age 10, Ethan often had to look after himself, managing alone for meals and even overnight on occasions without a phone for emergencies. He sometimes sought help from neighbors due to his parents' frequent absences related to work or social events. One neighbor was alarmed enough to report their concerns to Child Protective Services, although it remains uncertain what action, if any, CPS took. As Ethan entered his sophomore year at Oxford High, his academic performance declined. In addition, according to court documents, by early 2021, he started verbalizing situations he was experiencing at home that suggested problems with his mental health. For example, in March of that year, Ethan, having been left alone again, sent many texts to his mother asking her to return home. He said he was scared because he thought someone else was in the house. He texted, "There's someone in the house, I think. Someone walked into the bathroom and flushed the toilet and left the light on." and I thought it was you, but when I came out, there was no one home. 10 minutes later, Ethan followed up with a final text, asking, when are you going to be home? Cell phone records from the Crumbleys indicate that neither parent reached out to Ethan that night. Roughly 1 week later, Ethan, home alone again, texted his mother that he believed demons were causing disturbances in the house. Messages included, okay, the house is now haunted. I'm scared. I got some videos and a picture of the demon. Growing anxious for a response, Ethan later added, can you at least text back? Again, neither parent replied to his messages. Meanwhile, photos on her cell phone showed she was busy taking pictures of James and herself horseback riding when Ethan sent his messages. The most extensive text exchanges were between Ethan and his closest friend. In April of 2021, Ethan confided to his friend that he had told his parents he was hearing and seeing things that weren't there. He wanted to see a doctor. However, James dismissed his plea, instead offering him some pills and advising him to suck it up. Jennifer allegedly reacted with laughter, choosing to attribute his condition to drug use, which deeply upset Ethan. He thought about dialing 911 for immediate medical attention, but decided against it, fearing the wrath of his parents. The court record would eventually include many other similar text message threads. Ethan also kept a journal. The journal referenced his one close friend, contained a drawing of a decapitated bird, depicted a demon, and discussed various other issues in Ethan's life. Every one of the 21 pages of written material had reference to plans to attack students. Ethan partially blamed his parents in the journal, writing, I have fully mentally lost it after years of fighting with my dark side. My parents won't listen to me about help or a therapist, and I have zero help for my mental problems, and it's causing me to blank up the effing school. This context helps to set up the horrific events at Oxford High on November 30th, 2021. On Friday, November 26th, James and Ethan entered a shooting goods store in Oxford to buy a 9mm SIG Sauer handgun requested by Ethan. The form James was required to sign indicated that purchasing a gun for someone else was illegal. Eventually, the background check cleared and James bought the firearm. At some point that day, he handed the gun to his son, along with extra magazines of ammunition. On or around the same day, Ethan posted a photo on his Instagram with the caption, Just got my new beauty today, SIG Sauer 9mm. Ask any questions, I will answer. On or about November 27th, Jennifer Crumbley posted on her Instagram account, Mom and Son Day, testing out his new Christmas present. Jennifer had taken Ethan to a shooting range. Upon arrival, Jennifer purchased 30 minutes of range time, paper targets, and two boxes of 9mm ammunition. A surveillance video from the range showed Jennifer and Ethan firing the gun. Ethan went first and then showed his mother how to load and shoot the gun. 2 days later, in the early hours of the morning, Jennifer conducted an internet search on treatment options for clinical depression, although the court document did not specify for whom. Later that morning, a teacher at Oxford High School witnessed Ethan searching online for ammunition on his phone. The teacher informed the dean of students, who instructed the school counselor to contact the Crumbleys. After speaking with Ethan, who explained shooting guns was just a family hobby, the counselor left a voicemail for Jennifer but received no reply. The school then emailed both parents, and again, there was no reply from either parent. Later, Jennifer exchanged text messages with Ethan, saying, Seriously? Looking up bullets in school? Followed by, LOL, I'm not mad at you. You have to learn not to get caught. On Tuesday, November 30th, Jennifer went to work, James went to the barn to check on a sick horse, and Ethan went to school. The day began like most others for the students of Oxford High. They entered the school and headed to their lockers to grab books and supplies. They briefly mingled with friends in the hallways, sharing updates and plans for the day. The warning bell ushered them into their classrooms, where they settled into their seats, ready for the day's lessons to begin. But not all was routine for Ethan Crumbley. In his backpack was his journal and the recently purchased Sig Sauer handgun. While in English class, Ethan was observed watching a shooting video on his cell phone, which the teacher reported to the dean. The dean then forwarded the matter to the school counselor by email. By the time the counselor received the message, Ethan was in math class. Simultaneously, Ethan's math teacher sent another message to the dean containing a photograph of Ethan's handwriting and drawings on a math worksheet. This prompted the dean to visit the counselor's office in person to discuss the worksheet, leading the counselor to retrieve the actual document. However, by then, Ethan had made significant changes to it, including crossing out violent imagery and replacing it with positive phrases. Later, both parents arrived at the school to meet with the counselor and Ethan. When the Crumbleys entered the counselor's office, they didn't greet, touch, or hug Ethan, which the counselor found bizarre. The counselor, having provided the worksheet earlier, informed the couple about the video Ethan watched in English class and expressed concerns about his mental health. He offered mental health resources and suggested they take Ethan to a doctor or therapist that day. Jennifer objected, saying it was impossible because she and James had to return to work. James offered no resistance. Despite his surprise, the counselor insisted Ethan get medical attention within 48 hours. Since no disciplinary issue required Ethan to leave school, it was decided he would stay. As they left, neither parent hugged or said goodbye to Ethan. Seeing he wasn't receiving parental support, the counselor reassured Ethan, stating, "I just want you to know, I care about you." Within minutes of leaving the school, call records reveal Jennifer contacted her riding instructor to discuss a horse riding lesson scheduled for that evening. James logged on to DoorDash and accepted his first delivery job at 11 a.m. At around 12:21 in the afternoon, Jennifer texted Ethan asking if he was okay. She then wrote, "You know you can talk to us and we won't judge," to which Ethan responded at 12:42 p.m., "I know, thank you. I'm sorry for that. I love you." Within minutes of sending that message, media outlets nationwide reported a major event.
It's happened yet again in America. The parents of three teenagers learned today their children will not be coming home from school. The parents of seven others finding out their kids are in hospitals with bullet wounds. Yet another school shooting. The 58th shooting on school grounds this year, according to gun safety advocacy group Everytown. This time it happened in Oxford, Michigan, population 3,500 outside Detroit. Cops there say a 15-year-old student brought a semi-automatic handgun to school and opened fire. They say he shot off 15 to 20 bullets, killed three students, shot eight other people, including a teacher. The undersheriff in Oakland County there says deputies took the suspect into custody within about 5 minutes of the final shots. No struggle at all. He says the student is not cooperating. Michigan's Governor Gretchen Whitmer calling the shooting an unimaginable tragedy.
I think we need to focus on the community, the families, supporting all the first responders, including the incredible people at our hospitals that are working so hard to save the lives of those who are fighting for their lives right now. I think this is every parent's worst nightmare.
Police say the student acted alone and that so far they have no idea what his motive was.
By 12:58 p.m., the immediate threat was over, and Oxford High School sent out alert messages to parents. Jennifer Crumbley received the information while at work and started screaming. At 1:22 p.m., she texted her son, "Ethan, don't do it!" But by that point, her son had surrendered to law enforcement. Upon receiving the alert, James drove home in search for the Sig Sauer and ammunition. He did not find it. At 1:34 p.m., he called 911.
911, what's the location of your emergency?
Okay, I'm not really sure. I'm at my house. There's an active shooter situation going on at the high school. My son goes to the high school. I have a missing gun at my house. I need an officer to come to my house right away, please.
Okay, I'm not going to be able to send anybody to your house right now, sir. They're on the active shooter situation right now.
I understand that. There's a million cops there. I have a missing gun, and my son is at the school, and we had to go meet with the counselor this morning because of something that he wrote on a test paper, and then I was in town, and I saw a whole bunch of cops going somewhere, and I made sure that I wanted to get to the high school to see if something was going on in the high school, and then somebody told me that there was an active shooter, and then I raced home just to, like, find out.
Okay.
And I think my son took the gun. I don't know if it's him. I don't know what's going on. Freaking out.
I understand.
My son's name is Ethan Crumbley, C-R-U-M-B-L-E-Y.
E-L-E-Y. All right, sir, I'm going to put you on hold for just one second, okay? I have to talk to command and see if I can do anything for you, okay? I'm going to put you on hold.
Thank you.
Authorities arrested and charged Ethan as an adult for 24 crimes, including murder and terrorism. On the day of the shooting, police executed a search warrant for Crumbley's home and began a comprehensive investigation. It was apparent that the Crumbleys felt targeted by the probe, as evident by a text message sent from Jennifer to her boss at 1:31 a.m. on December 2nd, which said, "We're on the run again. Helicopters. Not sure where to. I'll message you." Later that day, authorities issued arrest warrants against the Crumbleys for 4 counts of involuntary manslaughter. The following morning, Oakland County Prosecutor Karen McDonald publicly announced the charges and urged the Crumbleys to surrender. Instead, 2 hours after the announcement, they checked out of their motel and withdrew $4,000 from a bank. The U.S. Marshals were then called in to help locate them. By 5:30 p.m., wanted flyers with a $10,000 reward were circulated, seeking public assistance. At 10 p.m., police found their abandoned vehicle in downtown Detroit. Finally, on Saturday the 4th, the police received the tip they had hoped for.
Detroit 911, what is the address of the emergency?
1111 Bellevue Street.
Repeat the address for verification.
1111 Bellevue Street.
What's the corner cross street?
Lafayette and Bellevue.
Tell me exactly what happened.
The people who, the parents of the shooter that are running away, they're here.
Sir, I'm not sure what you're referring to. You have to be more specific. Tell me exactly what happened at the location. What's going on now?
Okay, so the Oakland shooter, the kid, has the two parents that are on the run right now, and it said, you know, Oakland County said, call if you see anything. And I just went to go park my car and switch it around at my office. I'm at my office, and there was a Kia that looked like their car, and I walked around and checked the license plate, and it's their car, and the woman is here next to the car.
The woman is where?
Sitting next to her car in the parking lot.
She's sitting next to her vehicle on the ground or in another vehicle?
Yeah, on the ground. On the ground.
Okay, and what kind of vehicle is this, sir?
It's a 2021 Kia. It's a black Kia SUV in the parking lot.
Was anyone inside of the vehicle?
I don't know.
You stated you walked around the vehicle and looked inside. You didn't?
I walked back to look at the license plate because I saw online that that car was matching.
Do you have the plate number?
One second. It's,
okay. And the vehicle, was it parked in a parking lot and the mother was on?
Yes. Yep.
Okay.
It's next to my car in the parking lot. I'm inside my office now.
And the mother is sitting on the ground. What is she wearing?
Yes. She's wearing a hoodie, but I don't know what kind.
What color is the hoodie?
I don't know. I think it was plaid, but I saw her for a glimpse, and then I, like, ran inside because I, like, my heart sank.
So you're not sure what color the hoodie was, but you've seen her sitting there?
Yeah.
Okay, so what's your name? We're looking units in that area. Thank you.
Okay, yeah, they're, I can't believe it. They're here.
Okay.
Okay. Do you want me to stay on, or am I?
No, sir, you're fine.
Okay. Mm-hmm. All right. Yeah, they're here. That's crazy. Like, that's who the people are looking for.
Okay, so they'll be there shortly. So thank you.
Okay, thanks. Bye.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Let me see those hands! Let me see those fucking hands! What was that guy? Let me see those hands! Yep. Hey, let me see hands! 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 Keep those hands where they're at! Come on, I'm gonna go hands. Turn around. On your stomach. Get on your fucking stomach! Hands behind your head. Oh, God.
The police captured the Crumbleys and transported them to the county jail, where Ethan was also in custody. They were each placed in isolation. Hours later, James and Jennifer Crumbley appeared for arraignment via remote hearing.
Thank you. Who is going to speak on behalf of the prosecutor's office?
I am, Your Honor.
Go ahead.
Your Honor, I'm sure you've read the swear to you. Pursuant to MCR 6.106, a bond should be set with the considerations of the likelihood of conviction first. Here, the likelihood of conviction is strong. Your Honor, we know from the facts and that were presented at the swear to you that the Crumbleys, Mr. Crumbley, purchased this weapon for his son. And that on the 27th, Mrs. Crumbley went to the shooting range with her son, posted on social media saying that it was a Mother's Sunday and that she was, she bought a weapon for her, a gun for her baby for Christmas. It's also clear from the facts that he had total access to this weapon and that it was for him. Second, on the 29th, both defendants were aware that he was searching ammunition on his phone at school. Instead of reacting to that as a concerned parent and worried about safety, Mrs. Crumbley texted, LOL, just, I'm not mad, just next time, don't get caught. And then obviously on this very tragic day, on the 30th, they were called to the school and about their son's drawing, which clearly depicted threats and acts of violence. And instead of disclosing to the school that he had full access to this weapon, they chose not to. They chose not to take their son home. They chose not to tell anybody that he might be dangerous when it was clear and they had every likelihood that he was. And instead they left. Furthermore, after the active shooting announcement went out, Mrs. Crumbley texted her son, Ethan, don't do it. And Mr. Crumbley went to his home purposely to search for this weapon because he was afraid his son had the weapon and was in fact shooting people and hurting them, which as we know is exactly what happened. Your Honor, this is a very serious, horrible, terrible murder and shooting, and it has affected the entire community. And these two individuals could have stopped it. And they had every reason to know that he was dangerous and they gave him a weapon and they didn't secure it and they allowed him free access to it. Furthermore, Your Honor, the purpose of bond is to secure further court appearances. And yesterday they were charged with these counts of voluntary manslaughter. Now, Your Honor, the communication between Mrs. Smith and the prosecutor's office was a text message that was sent to me and was not replied to. And you know, we don't have an obligation to cooperate, and there are good reasons for that. And I think the fact that the events that played out show the reasons for that. Now, Mrs. Smith clearly her clients did not give her, tell her the truth, because her representation was they wanted to turn themselves in and that they were on their way to do that. However, they didn't turn themselves in, and we were told they were out of town, except that yesterday morning they withdrew $4,000 from an ATM in Rochester Hills, very close to the court where they could have turned themselves in with no events and no efforts on behalf of law enforcement. Instead, they fled, and they sought multiple attempts to hide their location and were eventually tracked down after they parked their car somewhere. A witness saw it, and the entire fugitive apprehension team with multiple other law enforcement agencies went into a vacant building and searched it from top to bottom. And these two individuals were found locked somewhere in a room hiding. These are not people that we can be assured will return to court on their own. And then lastly, pursuant to MCR 6.106, we also should consider, or the court should consider, whether or not there are members of the community to vouch. There are none here. In fact, there are none here because there's not one person in that community that will vouch for these two defendants. So I'm asking that you set a $500,000 bond for both defendants, cash surety.
The judge agreed and imposed a combined $1 million bond. Following the arraignment, 2 years of legal maneuvers ensued, including evidence gathering and pretrial hearings. In November 2023, a judge granted Jennifer's request to sever her trial from James's, raising speculation as to whether she would try to throw her husband under the bus. Legal strategy aside, this landmark case would attract national media attention due to its potential to significantly influence the interpretation of parental responsibility regarding gun ownership and the measures expected of parents to prevent mass tragedies. On January 25, 2024, opening arguments were heard in the trial of the people of Michigan versus Jennifer Crumbley. Would Crumbley be the first parent in United States history to be found criminally responsible for a mass school attack conducted by their child? To prove the state's case against Jennifer, Assistant Prosecutor Mark Keast sought to establish four key elements. 1. Ethan Crumbley presented a danger to the community. 2. That danger was obvious to a reasonable person. 3. Jennifer Crumbley neglected to diligently address and/or divert that danger. And 4. The neglect and subsequent danger were substantial factors in the four deaths of the children at Oxford High.
I want to introduce you to Hannah St. Juliana, Madison Baldwin, Tate Muir, and Justin Schilling. They died on November the 30th of 2021. They weren't in a car crash. They weren't sick. They were murdered in an act of terror committed by Jennifer Crumbley's 15-year-old son. Jennifer Crumbley didn't pull the trigger that day, but she is responsible for those deaths. These kids were gunned down inside Oxford High School with this gun. It's a 6-hour, 9mm handgun purchased 4 days before the shooting by James Crumbley, Jennifer's husband and father of the school shooter. This was a purchase celebrated by Jennifer on Instagram. These are her words. This is her post. Mom and son day testing out his new Christmas present. My first time shooting a 9mm, I hit the bullseye. The evidence will prove that by the time this gun was bought, the school shooter was in a downward spiral that had begun months before. The evidence will also show you that Jennifer Crumbley was aware of that. Despite her knowledge of his deteriorating mental crisis, despite her knowledge of his growing social isolation, despite the fact that it is illegal for a 15-year-old to walk into a gun store and walk out with a handgun by himself, this gun was gifted. You will also learn that despite all of that background, this firearm was not secured in a way to prevent her son from gaining access to it. The evidence will also prove to you that even with all of that, on November the 30th, Jennifer Crumbley was still given the opportunity to prevent these murders from ever happening. Instead, she chose to do nothing.
On my way to court today, I blasted Taylor Swift to warm up my voice and calm my nerves. And there was a line in one of her songs that summarized what this case is about. Band-aids don't stop bullet holes. And that's what this case is about. It's about the prosecution attempting to put a band-aid on problems that can't be fixed with a band-aid. The prosecution has charged Jennifer Crumbley with involuntary manslaughter in an effort to make the community feel better, in an effort to make people feel like someone is being held responsible, in an effort to send a message to gun owners, and none of those problems will be solved by charging Jennifer Crumbley with involuntary manslaughter.
In a criminal trial, lawyers on both sides are expected to treat each other with respect. They argue strongly for their clients, but still observe the court's rules of decorum. Usually, this isn't a problem, but in this case, there was real tension between the parties throughout the proceedings.
Your Honor, this court, upon the defense's request, instructed the prosecutors not to show emotion. You instructed the prosecutors to tell our witnesses not to show emotion. And you instructed us to let our victims know. I understand the ruling, Your Honor. I do. You're concerned about influence of the jury. I take no issue with it. But it was a difficult thing. It's difficult, and we're doing it. And then to have not just the defendant, her lawyer, sit there sobbing. I just want to finish, Your Honor. I think if that is the instruction, we are trying really hard to respect the court's instruction because I understand the reason for it.
Okay, I didn't tell people not to show emotion. Some of that is involuntary, but there have been times in this courtroom during trials when people will show facial expressions or things like that, or make comments. I understand. This is a very emotional situation for everyone here, right? If someone was audibly sobbing in the audience, I would hope that they would exit. And as you said, you know the reason for it. I didn't tell anybody not to show emotion. I guess some emotion is involuntary. So I guess I'm asking what you're asking of me.
I think it should apply to both sides.
Judge, first of all, I was not sobbing, and this is horrific.
I've never seen this before.
It's horrific. That's why we asked the court not to play it. This is horrific. I don't know how the prosecutor. She's watched it 100 times with these witnesses. It's horrific.
You had this video over two.
I don't know. I don't have this video. I have to go to their office to watch it.
You've seen it.
No, I haven't. Because it's not necessary. It's not relevant to my client's case. We've already litigated this, but we're doing our best. We were not sobbing or making a scene in any way. All my eye makeup's still on. I checked my camera. I need a break.
Okay, we're having a break. That's what we're doing.
Oxford High School counselor Sean Hopkins testified about the meeting he had with the Crumbleys on the morning of November 30th. Just hours before the tragic events occurred.
All right. Now, you testified that it was your hope that they would take him home that day. What do you mean by that?
I wanted to make sure the student was able to get the support that I felt was needed, and I was wanting it to be as soon as possible.
Okay. Did you feel like that he could be left alone at that point?
I did not want him left alone at that point. In fact, that's why I kept him in my office until I could make contact with him.
Okay, and you communicated that to the defendant?
I do not remember if I communicated that to the defendant.
Okay. So when you discussed, well, first of all, did you communicate your hope that they take him home to the defendant?
Yes, I my words were I want him to be seen as soon as possible, today if possible, and I actually provided a list of mental health resources and handed that to mom.
Now, when you say a list of mental health resources, could you explain a little bit more what that means?
Yeah, it was multiple pages of different services throughout the area, what they specialized in, whether they accepted insurance or not, and contact information for those different therapeutic options.
Okay, and that was actually provided to the defendant and her husband?
I handed it to mom.
Okay. Now, when you communicated your expectation, what was Jennifer Crumbley's response?
I didn't feel as if it was going to be an absolute no, but it was made quite clear that it wasn't possible to do it that day.
Why do you say it was made clear it wasn't possible to do it that day?
That they had to return to work and they were unable to do it that day.
Well, who said that?
Mom.
Mom is in Jennifer Crumbley?
Yes.
Did she speak for James or did James speak as well?
I don't remember James speaking on that topic.
So what happened next?
My comment was, then I said I'd like to see him as soon as possible. Today is possible. I was told today is not possible, so I said, is 48 hours possible? I will be following up.
In those dozens of meetings in the past, had anyone ever said that they couldn't have their son go with them that day?
I had not had that happen in a situation.
Your Honor, I don't object to the relevance.
It's the same response as the last objection.
Okay, well, I guess you'd want to back up even further. Had you ever asked parents to take their child home with them that day? Have you ever requested that before?
I've encouraged parents to be able to get their son and or daughter help and therapy. I had never had it where it was feeling like I needed to push to make it happen.
And you say the feeling like you needed to push to make it happen. That's what you're experiencing November the 30th, 2021.
That is correct.
Okay. So tell me what's going on through your mind at this point.
I was a little caught off guard and a little confused because it was something that I wasn't really expecting that type of response, especially when parents came, and in fact both parents came, which I wasn't expecting nor did I request. I was a little surprised at their willingness to come, but then not completely follow through.
Okay. Now, you told the defendant or husband that your opinion was this drawing showed suicidal ideation. Is that right?
That was my opinion, and I did not. I saw it as somebody who was showing signs that could be associated with suicide, and so I took that and out of just an abundance of caution, wanted to make sure that the student was able to get help.
Okay. But you communicated that to the defendant.
I did.
In one especially heated moment, the prosecutors took offense to specific casual comments made by defense attorney Smith, including remarks such as, "I'm going to kill myself," and "I'm going to drink 5 bottles of wine." While the court noted that attorney Smith did not intend for these comments to be taken seriously, prosecutors asked the court to instruct counsel to adhere to the court's rules.
One thing I think is important, I asked this court to instruct counsel to show the appropriate decorum in this particular case, the jokes indicating I'm going to kill myself in a joking manner, I'm drinking five bottles of wine.
It's just, there are parents who had their children murdered in this courtroom, and we are the people who communicate with them after we leave here.
I said something about wine because I was looking at her exhibit and it was teetering, and I was trying to nicely suggest that I would like you.
But making a joke about killing yourself in this courtroom at this time, I understand.
I didn't mean it like that. I'm sorry. I am so sorry. I did not mean it like that.
Stop yelling. I
did not mean it like that. And they know I didn't mean it like that.
Okay. We're responding to literally just sitting here, the amount of messages we get from victims in the community. And I just think, just to be at an abundance of respect and caution, if we could just not say things like that. I'm not accusing anyone of any malice or any bad intent. I'm just asking that we just not engage in that because this is hard enough for the people who are sitting here now and who will be sitting here next week.
I understand. It's very hard.
Your Honor, I am not joking around about anything.
Okay, I think it was a slip of the tongue. Right? Emotions are running high. we also, a lot of people are saying Nathan is the shooter. But
Your Honor, I do want to make a point. I'm not making an objection because my emotions are running high. In fact, I'm not having an emotional response here. I am simply asking that we be respectful to victims. That's it.
Your Honor, I am being respectful. So to be, that is implying I'm being disrespectful. Me saying I'm going to kill myself, I didn't mean in any way to offend these families.
I know you didn't. It was a slip on the tongue. She's just.
It was absolutely not related to them.
I know.
This shooting is awful. It's the prosecution that's parading all of this up here and putting
the parading? The shooting is the result of the defendant's gross negligence. That is the case.
Okay. They are the ones putting the victims through reading all of this over and over and over.
Whoa. Everybody needs to go home.
In a bombshell revelation, the court discovers an improper relationship between a local firefighter and Jennifer Crumbley in the months leading to the school incident. Expecting the prosecutors to exploit this revelation to argue that Crumbley was preoccupied with herself and not caring for her son, defense attorney Smith seeks to persuade the firefighter that his statements to the police about the relationship were coerced, possibly making them inadmissible.
Now, the prosecution may ask you a lot of questions.
Objection in the form of the question doesn't matter, but I ask them now, Judge.
I haven't even asked my question.
Okay, what's the question?
My question is, when you talked to law enforcement and you changed...
Again, I'm sorry, specifics matter. Okay, so if counsel is going to request... This kind of question from the witness, she has to be specific.
I can't even get my question out.
Okay, well, he needs to know because there are three different times, so that would help him too.
Thank you, Judge.
Okay. Over the course of the investigation, you testified earlier that your answers to certain questions have changed. Correct?
Yes, I've added.
You've added. Okay. But one thing you have not changed, it's not the statements about your sexual relationship with Jennifer Crumbley. You've always said you had a sexual relationship.
Correct.
As police came and talked to you a second and a third time, they wanted more details about where you had sex and other details about those experiences, correct?
Correct.
Now, when I was asking you if you felt like you were threatened in any way, that had to do with feeling threatened that your job was at issue or that your benefits could be lost,
Judge,
correct?
I object again, form the question. She needs to be specific. She's going to ask something like threats. That needs to be specific.
Okay, then I'll go to the third interview. I'm sorry.
Yeah, be specific.
Okay, I'm going to be very specific. In the third interview, when you talked to them in December, they specifically said to you, talk to you about your job employment as a firefighter, correct?
Correct.
They specifically talked to you about the details of your benefits, including your pension, correct?
Correct.
They made you feel like if you didn't give answers, they wanted...
That's in the form of the question. They made you feel. How could he possibly testify to what somebody else's intent was? That would be speculation.
I'll ask how he felt.
Okay.
When you were in that third interview... You were scared at the thought of losing your job or benefits.
No, I was not.
Sir, tell us, you've reviewed the autopsy protocol in this case?
Yes, sir.
Do you know the identities of the victims who were murdered on November the 30th?
I do.
Okay. I'm going to show you what's been admitted, stipulated to as Exhibit 418. Who is that?
That's Hannah St. Juliana.
Okay. And how old was she when she was killed?
14.
And sir, can you tell us, please, how she was killed?
The official cause of manner of death from the autopsy protocol is multiple gunshot wounds, homicide. She was shot in her upper torso, her abdomen, her thighs.
Could you refer to Exhibit 2?
I'm sorry, enter the form.
Okay.
I'm sorry.
Joining the topic. Referring to Exhibit 2 now.
Lieutenant, can you tell me if you need did I promote or promote your lieutenant? Can you tell me if you need a break?
Yes. Okay. Yeah, I'm sorry.
Just let me know, okay?
Yep, thank you.
Now, this is People's 419 on the screen. I'm also referring to, this has been stipulated too, also referring to Exhibit 2, autopsy protocol for Madison Baldwin. Sir, how old was she when she was killed on November the 30th?
17 years old.
And how did she die?
Again, cause of manner of death was gunshot wound to the head. Manner of death was homicide. It was a close contact shot, meaning the firearm was either on or near the victim's head when the trigger was pulled.
Referring now to Exhibit 3. That's an autopsy protocol for Justin Schilling, is that right?
I think I have 10 years through. Okay, Justin Schilling's 4.
Thank you, Tamir. And how old was he when he was killed?
Tamir was 16 years old.
This is Exhibit 420, it's been stipulated too. Tell us please how Tate was killed.
Again, the cause and manner of death from the autopsy protocol was gunshot wound. Tate had multiple gunshot wounds. Manner of death was homicide. Tate was shot in the back of the head at a further distance.
Now, Exhibit 4, sir. Is this the autopsy protocol for Justin Schilling?
Yes.
I'm showing what's been admitted. Stipulated to for admission is People's Exhibit 421. Sir, is that Justin Schilling?
It is.
How old was he when he was killed?
17 years old.
Tell the jury, please, how he died.
Justin Schilling, you'll see, you'll observe, but he was cause and manner of death from the autopsy protocol was gunshot wound to the head, homicide. He was also shot at close contact to the back of the head.
Sir, were others wounded and suffered gunshot wounds as well inside the school?
Yes.
Do you know their names?
I do.
Can you tell us who they are, please?
There's Phoebe Arthur, Elijah Mueller, Kylie Osage, Riley Franz, John Asciutto, Aiden Watson, and Molly Garnell, who testified earlier.
Thank you, sir.
All right, Mrs. Crumbley, can you please start by identifying yourself? Tell the jury who you are.
My name is Jennifer Crumbley, and I'm a defendant in this case.
And how old are you?
I'm 45.
Mrs. Crumbley, the jury has heard so much testimony. Do you agree?
Yes.
I'm going to go a little bit faster through things, and if there's something we need to explain, or if I'm cutting you off, let me know.
Okay.
And you understand that as I speak, you have to wait for me to finish speaking?
Correct.
Okay. So, Mrs. Crumbley, very briefly, go ahead and tell the jury what you did for a living.
I was a marketing director at a real estate acquisition company.
And how long did you hold that position?
5 years.
Now, does that kind of position include any kind of presentations or public speaking, anything like that?
Not a lot.
Okay. And how do you feel right now about talking to this jury?
Public speaking is probably my biggest fear, so very nervous.
Okay. And at times, you have been upset during this trial, is that correct?
Correct.
Are you okay to keep proceeding?
Yes.
I want you to tell this jury just a little bit about your personality, and I think we've seen some of it on the videos. Is that fair to say?
Yeah.
Okay, let's talk about when you have a really stressful situation. what is your, like, let's say an animal dies in your family or a person. There's two more dates I need to ask you about. I'm going to go to April 4th, which was a Sunday, and that is going to be exhibit that was admitted 101, okay? So exhibit 101 are text messages, and these are between, who are these between?
Those were between my son and his friend.
Okay. Now, prior to this case, did you ever see any of these messages?
I did not.
Were you aware any of them existed?
I was not.
Okay, so this is from April 4th, and your son's saying, he's the one sending messages that say, I hear people talking to me and someone in the distance. I actually asked my dad to take me to the doctor yesterday, but he gave me some pills and told me to suck it up. Like, it's at the point I'm asking to go to the doctor. Was there ever a time where he asked to go to the doctor around this time?
I don't think so, no.
Then he says, my mom laughed when I told her. Was there ever a time where he's asking for help and you're laughing?
No.
He writes to his friend, and this is just later that night, but I'm having bad insomnia and paranoia, and I need help. I was thinking of calling 911 so I could go to the hospital, but then my parents would be really pissed. Okay, so this is all one long conversation, is that right?
Correct.
He says, I'm going to ask my parents to go to the doctors tomorrow or Tuesday again, but this time I'm going to tell them about the voices. This text message or instant message thread, did you ever, were you even aware of this?
No.
Do you remember any time where he came and talked to you and said anything about hearing voices?
No.
Do you recall there ever being a time where he asked you for to go to a doctor or to get help and you said no?
No.
Or laughed at him?
No.
From the testimony about to give as a true self-advocate.
I do.
So you can put your hand down, and could you state your name again for the record and spell your first and last name?
My name is Jennifer Crumbley, J-E-N-N-I-F-E-R-C-R-U-M-B-L-E-Y.
Go ahead, Prosecutor.
Thank you. Mrs. Crumbley, I'd like to talk to you about your vigilance as a parent. But before I do, I want to make sure that you understood the oath that you just took.
I do.
Okay, you understand that. You took the stand under oath, then you have to tell the truth?
I do.
You understand that was the rules yesterday as well?
Correct.
All right, we're going to come back to that. Now, you have been described by your attorney as a hyper-vigilant parent.
Correct.
Okay, do you agree with that?
I do.
In fact, you called yourself a helicopter parent before.
Yes, I was.
So you told us that you spent a lot of family time together.
We did.
Now, I'd like to talk to you about what your digital footprint shows.
Okay.
What the evidence on your phone shows.
Okay.
Now, it's true, you agree with me, that having horses is a pretty time-consuming hobby.
It can be.
Okay. It was for you.
It can be.
And that's what you said yesterday?
Yes.
Okay. And you were at the barn for between 3 and 5 times a week?
More like 3 times a week.
3 times a week, yeah. For a couple hours a trip?
Correct.
Okay. It's also an expensive hobby.
It is.
So your banking records show that in the year 2021, you spent over $20,000 on the horses. Is that correct?
Probably.
Okay. And that's not including cash. That's just from Capital One and Flagstar Bank.
Correct.
In fact, you told a coworker that half of your salary basically goes to the horses.
I might have, yes.
Now, except on rare occasion, you didn't bring your son with you to the barn.
He was not into horses. I would ask every time I went to the barn, but he didn't want to go.
So the answer was no?
No.
Okay. And at least as far as your horses being boarded with Kira Pennock from June of 2021 to November of 2021, your son never went with you. Is that correct?
I think he went once when my in-laws were in town and we met them at the barn.
Okay. But there was nothing stopping you from taking him?
No, he just didn't want to go.
Okay. It's a family atmosphere.
It can be.
Okay, like the Halloween party that she had. That was for families.
Yeah, most of the kids there are young.
Okay. In the winters, you were on ski patrol as well.
Correct.
Okay. And that can be a bit of a time-consuming hobby.
It can be.
All right, and you would be in ski patrol between one and two times a week?
It's a total of 10 hours a week.
10 hours a week, okay. So how many days?
I did doubles on Saturday, so one day a week for me.
Okay, so you told this jury yesterday, you depicted your affair with Mr. Malash as a one time a week meetup at a Costco parking lot. Is that your testimony?
Correct.
Okay, but it wasn't just that, was it?
No.
Okay. In fact, there are numerous photographs sent to Mr. Malash.
Okay.
Yes or no?
I'm sure there was.
Okay. Numerous messages exchanged with him.
Correct.
And it wasn't just during the week, Monday through Friday, was it?
No.
No. In fact, that's what you said yesterday. But in fact, it included trips.
There were actual business trips that he met me on.
Okay. And it included other individuals.
Yes.
What's Adult Friend Finder?
It's where you can go on and meet people who meet certain tastes that you're looking for.
This is 429. And you had the app Adult Friend Finder on your phone?
I do not believe I had the app.
Okay, it was found on your phone.
Okay, well, I guess it was on my phone.
Okay, and there were messages from you to other individuals.
Correct.
Your Honor, I would object that this is going outside of the scope of the affair with Brian, but...
I don't think the court's ruling on opening the door was confined to just her extramarital affair with Brian Lynch.
Well, I guess with regard to Mr. Malash, I determined that the defense opened the door. I don't know that I determined that the defense opened the door as to other...
She depicted herself as having one extramarital affair for about a six-month period of time, where she met with him one time a week. That was her testimony yesterday. We have evidence to the contrary, and I think it's important.
This is going to get exciting. Hi.
All right. Can
it is women's.
All right. Well, go ahead. But
I won't delve too far.
Okay, yeah. This jury has been here a long time, and...
I respect their time, Judge. I'll be brief.
You might have lost.
So, Mrs. Crumbley... I'm sorry, this is not a laughing matter. Mrs. Crumbley, on Adult Friend Finder, we see messages from you in at least of August of 2021, August the 4th, 2021.
Okay.
Okay, and you don't dispute August the 10th of 2021?
No.
August the 11th of 2021?
No.
And more importantly, November 21st, 2021?
No.
Okay, and more important than that, November the 28th, 2021?
No.
Okay, you don't dispute that evidence was found on your phone?
I don't dispute it.
Okay. And you don't dispute that it wasn't just you and Mr. Malash meeting after work hours, it was with you and Mr. Malash arranging with other individuals to meet after work as well?
No, I only met with Brian during work hours. The times that we were at the hotel, I was on business, we did arrange for other people to meet us there.
So Sunday, November the 28th, you remember that day? It was the day after you took your son to the shooting range.
I don't remember it.
You don't remember that day?
No.
2 days before the high school attack?
No, I don't remember what I did that day.
Okay. Well, you were pretty specific in what you did on November the 27th with the firearm. You remember that?
Correct.
All right. Now, November the 28th, 2021, you spent your time arranging a meetup with somebody on Adult Friend Finder.
I never met anybody on Adult Friend Finder.
Arranging a meetup.
Oh, okay.
I'm not just talking about the time that you spent physically with somebody. I'm talking about the time that you spent and devoted your energy to setting that up.
Okay.
And you'll agree with me, it's not just the time period at the Costco parking lot or the time period at the hotel or the time period on the trip, correct?
That's the only time I met with people.
Right. But that's not the only time that you devoted your own personal time and energy and focus to that, is it?
I guess I don't understand what you're asking.
Okay. Well, these meetups didn't just happen by themselves. You had to set them up.
Correct.
You weren't driven there. You weren't dropped off there. You set them up with somebody else.
Correct.
And that took your time and your energy and your focus to do so.
I don't believe it took too much time and energy, no.
Now, you told this jury that when your son texted you that he was seeing demons and bowls flying off the shelves, that was in the spring of 2021. You recall that evidence, right?
Correct.
You don't dispute that that was on your phone?
No.
And you don't dispute that at some point you read those messages?
No.
And you don't dispute that your son said at least one time, can you please text me back?
Correct.
Okay. You don't dispute that when you're at the barn, your other messages show that you can take pictures, send pictures, and receive pictures.
Usually I'm at the barn, if I take pictures and I try to send them, they don't go through right away, or I won't send them until I hit a spot where I actually have service.
So in Exhibit 423, the Facebook message chat between you and James, the chat that you deleted, there are a number of pictures that James sent to you from the barn of a horse in a conversation about that particular horse. Okay. Do you dispute that?
No.
Okay. And in fact, dozens and dozens of pictures of the like.
I'm sure, yes.
You're sure, okay. And those pictures were sent to you with a timestamp on that Facebook message chat.
Okay.
Do you dispute that?
No.
No. Okay. And then you responded in that same time frame. Do you dispute that?
No.
No. So that conversation with that picture that was taken at the barn was occurring while one of you were at the barn.
I'm sure it was.
Okay. Now, you don't deny that your son wrote in his journal that he asked his parents for help. You don't deny that evidence that was admitted?
No, I don't.
Okay. And you don't deny that he wrote in his journal that he now had access to the 6-hour 9mm handgun?
I do not deny that.
And you don't deny that the 6-hour 9mm handgun was in fact the murder weapon?
I don't deny that.
And you also don't deny that that gun was gifted by you and your husband to your son on November the 26th?
Describe gifted.
How about when you posted on Instagram his new Christmas gift?
Correct. And I explained yesterday that it was for him to use at the shooting range. We didn't just hand him a gun as a here you go, son. It was something he could use when we went to the range as a family together.
You don't deny that in April of 2021, you described your son as being depressed.
I didn't describe him as being depressed. I noticed that he was acting depressed.
You used the word depressed.
Yes. He was acting sad. Okay. He was acting depressed.
Okay. And you know what depressed means?
It means a lot of different things.
Well, to you, it meant depressed. And you wrote that.
Right.
You don't deny in April of 2021, the evidence shows that your son told his only friend that he had asked you for help.
No, I don't deny that.
Okay. And you also don't deny that he told his only friend that you laughed at him.
I do not deny that.
Now, yesterday you told us that you took those messages in the spring of 2021, which, by the way, is at the same time you started your affair with Mr. Malash?
Around that time.
Okay. So in the spring of 2021, when you sent those messages, or when you received those messages, you indicated it was messing around.
It was.
It was messing around. In your mind, messing around. That's what your testimony was.
Yes.
Okay. Even when he said, can you please text me back?
I didn't see his text message, so I didn't text him back.
Even when your phone logs show missed calls?
Can you ask that again?
Even when your phone logs show missed calls from your son in that time period?
No.
Now, you said yesterday about these messing around texts, you agree with me that there's no indication in any text message either between you and your son or any Facebook message between you and your husband in any of those exhibits, in fact anywhere on your phone, that indicated that any of those messages were a joke?
No, there weren't.
There weren't. And we're talking about hundreds of messages between you and your son and thousands of messages between you and your husband.
Correct.
And you don't deny that you never once took him to see a therapist or counselor?
No, I did not.
You did not.
After the jurors heard all the evidence, witnesses, closing arguments, and received jury instructions, it was time to deliberate.
Ladies and gentlemen, I've been informed that you have a verdict. Is that correct?
That is correct.
Are you the court person?
I am.
Could you please read your verdict?
Individually?
Sure.
Okay. On count one of involuntary manslaughter as to Madison Baldwin, we find the defendant guilty of involuntary manslaughter. On count two of involuntary manslaughter in regards to Tate Muir, we find the defendant guilty of involuntary manslaughter. On count three, as to involuntary manslaughter regarding Hannah St. Juliana, we find the defendant guilty of involuntary manslaughter. And in count four of involuntary manslaughter against Justin Schilling, we find the defendant guilty of involuntary manslaughter.
Thank you, for allowing me to be seated. And I'm going to dismiss all these all the jury.
Juror in seat number one, was that an effect?
The jury foreperson in this first of its kind trial is with us now. Alex, good morning to you. We're not mentioning your last name for your own privacy reasons. I have to say, to have you here, it's a privilege, because what we ask jurors to do in this country is really, really difficult.
Very difficult.
To sit in judgment of their fellow citizen, and that is something that you and your fellow jurors did. What was it like in that courtroom, having that responsibility and delivering that verdict yesterday?
There was definitely a weight. I think any time we entered the courtroom, there was an undeniable weight on us. We all took the responsibility that was put upon us seriously, and I'm just one of 12 that made a very difficult decision.
What was the evidence that swayed you in the end? You said it wasn't an easy decision. This wasn't a slam dunk.
Not easy at all. So speaking for myself, I know that each individual juror had their own opinion. This did this for one person, this convinced the other. For me, I just feel like Jennifer didn't separate her son from the gun enough to save those lives that day.
You felt she was the last person known to have had custody of the gun.
Yes.
And then somehow it ends up in his hands.
And I think the responsibility of securing the weapon then falls on her.
What about those text messages or journal entries or things that the jurors saw where it indicated that Ethan had asked for help and that his parents hadn't given him that help? Was that persuasive to you?
To me personally, it wasn't as impactful as the evidence of her having the gun. But I know for my fellow jurors that the notebook played a huge part. Mm.